was lost without a hope of being found. To sin I was a servant, I was bound. My life was going nowhere, no matter what I tried. I searched for peace, but nothing satisfied. Jesus Christ and the forever forgiveness that is offered freely by His blood. Hey, it's good to see you here tonight on the Wednesday night. And as you can tell by the children sprinting towards the back, namely mine, there is a special class for, I think, kiddos ages 4 years old on down. And away they go. All right. And signs all the way. Hey, we're going to be in the book of Acts tonight. So you can take your Bibles and turn with me, please, to Acts chapter number 1. And we'll look together in just a moment at several verses here. Acts and the first chapter. Acts chapter number 1. While you're turning, let me just say on behalf of my family, thank you very much for the opportunity to be able to participate in what is going on here at Fort Lauderdale Baptist Church. We're grateful for what God is doing here and what He's going to do in the future. You know, this whole week was set up a little bit different than what is normally set up because of the outreach that we had on Saturday, where we had six teens respond and pray to receive the Lord Jesus Christ as Savior. And then starting on a Thursday and Friday night, and then we had Saturday, and then now Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, set up a little bit differently. But I'm grateful, I'm thrilled with the opportunity that we've been able to have just to be together and hear what God's Word has to say. And I think it's been obvious, at least it is to me, that God has directed in each of the services as they built one on the other. It's not something that I designed. When it comes to what I'm going to preach, it is completely, I ask the Lord, and He directs my heart and my thoughts, and then I just deliver what He says. So it's not like I plan out the week of, oh, this one will build nicely on this one, which will build nicely on this one. But this week, it's been kind of set up that way. And if you've been here this week and you take notes at all, or you can remember back, things have just consistently moved, and then what He has put on my heart for tonight fits right in with that as well. Acts chapter 1. We're going to begin reading here in verse number 3 here. And just let's start in verse number 4. Acts chapter 1. We pick up where the Lord Jesus Christ has been crucified. He was buried. He rose again the third day, proving that He is the Son of the God. And now He gets ready to be ascended back to the Father. And He's kind of giving His last words to His disciples. Just before He goes. The apostles are there. There's some other followers that are there. The Lord Jesus Christ, in essence, says, okay, guys, real quickly, before I go, let me just tell you what the summarization of our time together has been. Now, I don't know if you've ever been around anyone before that has ever given last words, but if you're ever near someone and they know and you know that the words they're about to speak to you are their last words, well, those those kind of situations make you key in and pay attention a little bit more to what somebody is saying. If you know someone's about to pass away and they have something they want to tell you, then you listen carefully, because if they're going to use their last breath on this earth to give you a message, then it's something that's important to them. And if it's someone you care about, if it's important to them, then it's important to you as well. I joke sometimes about how some people, when they start saying certain phrases, you can pretty much guess if the last words that they're going to say. For instance, in the South, if somebody says, "Hey, y'all, watch this," that's usually the last words that person will ever say. Or if they say, "Oh, yeah, but can you do this?" then you pretty much know. Not those kind of last words, but the kind of last words that are said from someone who loves you and has something important to tell you. The story is told about a preacher whom God was using in a very special way to reach people with the gospel, and his people, the people to whom he preached, loved him dearly. This preacher was also a farmer, and one day while he was studying, he got a little bit weary of sitting down and studying, so he decided to walk around the farm. So he did. He got up, and it was common in these days for someone who, when they were studying, they would wear just like a loose-fitting robe over their clothing. So he got up and he began to walk around the farm, and he walked over to where an auger was auging up some corn. And he got a little bit too close, and it grabbed the looseness of his robe that he was wearing, and it actually pulled him into it and pulled his arm from his body. Well, in that time, there was nothing that doctors could do, and basically they knew he was going to die. So the leadership of the church, the men who helped him in the church, came to him. And a number of the people heard about it, how that he was going to die, and they gathered at the house where the doctor was doing all they could to make him comfortable. And the preacher said to one of the men that was near them, "Hey, listen, before I go, what I want you to tell the people is this." And then he said, "Tell them to stand up for Jesus." And as a result of that phrase given, the last words, we get the hymn that we sing, stand up for Jesus, you soldiers of the cross. So last words can be very important. Certainly that is true when it comes to the last words that the Lord Jesus Christ spake while he was here on this earth. And that's what we're going to pick up here in verse number 4 of Acts chapter 1. If you're physically able, would you mind standing with me? We'll show our public respect for the scriptures, and also it'll refresh us one last time before you're seated for a while. I'll stay standing, but you'll be seated in a moment. All right? Verse 4. "And being assembled together with them, Jesus commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but," and if your Bible is equipped with red letters where the Lord Jesus Christ speaks, you can see this is where he picks up, "wait for the promise of the Father, which, saith he, ye have heard of me. For John truly baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. When they therefore were come together, they," the disciples, "asked of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel?" What an interesting question. What a seemingly odd question. We're going to look and see why they asked this question and what the Lord's answer was to them. Father, help us please tonight as we learn the lessons we need to learn. I pray that you would convince us fully of the truth. Convince our hearts, our minds, our consciences, and may our lives line up with what it is that you have said. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, Father, I confess my inability to deliver this message with any power except for your being in it. So please, please do what only you can do. I need you and I know it. In the name of Jesus, certainly for your glory. Amen. Thank you for standing. You may be seated. Verse number 6 says, "When they were therefore come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel?" Okay, I don't know exactly who asked this question. If I were guessing among the disciples, well, let me ask you. If you're guessing at someone to just blurt out a question among the disciples, the ones that you're aware of, who would you guess would ask a question like this?
Peter.
Okay, this is who we blame for everything, so why not blame Peter for this as well? I see the Lord Jesus up on a hill, and he's speaking with his followers, 11 disciples. Of course, Judas is gone, and then perhaps some other followers as well, but men and women perhaps who were very close to him. And actually, it was men. We know it was because of the angel, what he spoke later on. But these men are gathered together, and Jesus is speaking to them, and he says, okay, I'm leaving, in essence, is what he's saying. But you guys wait in Jerusalem until the promise of the Father comes on you. That is the coming of the Spirit. So you guys wait. And while he's talking to them, the disciples are kind of reeling in their minds as to what it is he's saying. And then Peter, or one of them, says, Lord, wilt thou at this time again restore the kingdom to Israel? Now, in order to understand why he would ask this, you've got to understand the mindset from which these men came. In other words, you got to put yourself in their sandals just for a moment or two in order to get the way that they're thinking. And, by the way, what I'm about to tell you will make much of the Gospels make a lot more sense to you. That is, you'll understand it in context historically. The Jews, those who followed God, Jehovah, they were looking forward to the coming of the Messiah, and their thought was, because of the Old Testament prophecies, that when the Messiah came, he was going to not only make the relationship between man and God right, but this Messiah, this anointed one, the Christ, when he came to the earth, they believed, was also going to restore again the kingdom of Israel as a nation to be reckoned with in the world. In other words, it was going to be again like when David and Solomon reigned. He was going to sit on the throne. When he came, he was going to come in power. This is what they thought because they didn't fully understand the Old Testament prophecies. But this is what they thought would happen. That he would come and he would reign in power. At this time especially, they were so glad when Jesus came and claimed to be the Messiah, because right now Rome was ruling over them, and the hand of Rome was heavy on them, and they were sick of it. Many of the Jewish men had tried to form revolts, but revolt after revolt was crushed. Sometimes they would get glimmer of hopes from certain leaders that would get a group of men together who could fight against garrisons, but to defeat all of Rome just could not happen. So when Jesus Christ came and he claimed to be the Messiah, the anointed one, immediately, as soon as people started to believe that he might be, in fact, who he claimed to be, it caused their hearts to rejoice because they're thinking to themselves, okay, the Messiah is coming, and when the Messiah comes, he's setting up the kingdom, and when the kingdom is set up, we're going to rule and reign, and we're going to be a nation to be reckoned with, and again, we will be a mighty power on the earth. Okay, this is where it makes a lot of the Gospels make a lot more sense. Consider the disciples. Here they are, and Jesus calls them to join him. And they see Jesus Christ do signs and miracles that it would be impossible for anyone to do outside of the power of God himself. Unless God were with him, or else he were God himself, it would be impossible for anybody to do the things that Jesus Christ did. And Jesus Christ, as he did these miracles, was also at the same time saying, I am the Messiah. I am the anointed one. Remember Peter's confession? Who do men say that I am? The Lord Jesus Christ asked. And some say, well, you're a prophet. Some say you're Elias. Some say you're John the Baptist come back to life, which didn't make sense because they were alive at the same time. But Jesus says, but who do you say that I am? And Peter said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God, the anointed one, the sent one, the one who had been promised, who was going to set up this kingdom. So their whole mindset while these disciples are walking with the Lord Jesus Christ and learning from him is, we're walking with him, we're learning from him, but all of this is going to culminate, their thinking, into us amassing an army and be able to throw off Roman government. Okay, now, think what must have, with that mindset of the disciples, think what must have gone through their minds when they saw the Lord Jesus Christ do especially certain of the miracles. I think of feeding 5,000 on a hillside. Here's the Lord Jesus, and he's standing up, and he says, give the people to eat. We don't have anything. We have 5 loaves, 2 fishes. What is that among so many? Jesus takes it, and he breaks it, and he gives it out, and these disciples are thinking to themselves, oh man, this is going to be great. He's going to establish a kingdom. We can just have a few people grow a little bit of food. He can bless it and break it, and he'll feed us all. We are going to be living well with not very much work. This is going to be great. Or consider seeing the dead raised to life again. Lazarus, come forth. and Lazarus comes out alive from the tomb after being dead for 4 days, and they're thinking to themselves, "Oh, we're going to mass an army. We're going to go out and fight. This is going to be great, because when we go out and fight and somebody gets killed, then Jesus will say, hey, get back up. And at the end of the day, everybody gets back up, and back at it we go." It makes a little more sense why the disciples argued about who was going to sit on the right side and left side of the Lord Jesus Christ in the kingdom. Because they're thinking the Messiah has come, and he's come for the purpose of establishing this kingdom, and he's going to rule and reign. And they're thinking to themselves, we're on the ground level of this. So they're getting excited about this. They are thrilled. And then one day a group of religious leaders come, and they deliver Jesus into the hand of soldiers who beat the Lord Jesus Christ. And then after a mockery of a trial, they nail their king to a cross. And the disciples are just going, oh no! No, this is not what we thought. They go and hide, lock the door, because their whole concept of what Jesus was about was establishing this nation again. And now Rome is going to be coming after them as people who are trying to stir up other people to fight. Oh man, this is not good. And then 3 days later, Jesus comes back to life. And they're thinking to themselves, ha, 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 ha. Now it's time. Nobody will be able to refuse him now. Everybody will be on board now. Now it's time. Now it's time to get the army. Now it's time to have the sword. Now it's time to go out and fight and throw off the Roman government. Now it is time. This is going to be great. And they're thinking to themselves, this is going to be wonderful. And then they gather together with the Lord Jesus Christ in this meeting. And Jesus says, I'm leaving. But you wait in Jerusalem. What? So then one of the disciples, poor Peter, says, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? In other words, they're saying, Lord, is it time? Is it time for us to take up arms? Is it time to amass an army? Is it time for you to rule and reign, Lord? Is it time? And look at what Jesus says in verse number 7. And he said unto them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father hath put in his own power. In other words, Jesus says, hey, Peter, Matthew, hey, Bartholomew, listen. Hey, guys, look. You're looking for the wrong power at the wrong time. Jesus says to them, you're looking for power to overthrow. You're looking for power to rule and reign. You're looking for the wrong power. It's not for you to know the times nor the seasons which the Father has put in his own power. Leave that in the Father's hands, Jesus Christ says. You're looking for the wrong power for right now. And then he makes the well-known statement in verse number 8 of Acts number 1. And he says to them, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth. In other words, he says, Jesus is saying, in essence, this, in the passage that we have read, disciples, you're looking for the wrong power at the wrong time. Let me tell you the kind of power you need right now. It is not power to overthrow the government. It is not power to be in charge of the world politically. That is in God's hands, the Father's hands. Let him have it. But let me tell you the kind of power that you need. Okay, now friends, listen to me. I thank God that we live in the United States of America, where we are able to vote our conscience. And that it is possible for us to elect godly people into leadership. Not necessarily that we always get who we want. Not that it's always just up to us. But in the nation, we have the right to do it. I thank God for that. But let me tell you something. Just as surely as this was true then, it is true now. We do not need, in particular, power to rule this nation. That is not the power needed for believers right now. No. Now, believers ought to vote. and you ought to vote your conscience according to the scriptures. That is true. But that is not what is needed today. The power that is needed today is the same power that the Lord Jesus Christ told the disciples that they were going to receive here in the next several weeks. He says, you're going to receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, so that you can be witnesses unto me in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth. Here's what Acts 1:8 is. Acts 1:8 is this. It is the promise of power through the person of the Spirit for the purpose of proclaiming the gospel of Christ to people who need to know. Yeah. Acts 1:8 is the promise of power through the person of the Spirit for the purpose of proclaiming the gospel of Christ to people who need to know. Well, who needs to know? Who needs to know the gospel?
Everyone.
Who needs to hear about the Lord Jesus Christ? Well, doesn't everyone? Isn't everyone under sin's curse? Have not all sinned? Have not all come short of God's glory? Have we not all broken God's commandments? And thereby all men, have earned to themselves the judgment that comes to those who break God's law and go against God? Yes, everybody needs to hear the gospel. Everyone needs to be told, because everyone is under sin's curse. Young and old, rich and poor, black and white, regardless of ethnicity, every person needs to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. Those who want to hear it, who are searching, need to hear it. Those who are not searching need to hear the gospel. All people, everywhere, every nation, every continent, every background, every religion need to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ, because everybody's under sin's curse. Everybody needs to hear, because Christ died for everyone. The blood of the Lord Jesus Christ was not shed for a few. It was shed for the sins of the world. And all those who will come by faith, putting their trust and dependence in Jesus and Jesus alone to be the forever forgiveness of their sins, any person can have their sins forgiven who will come to God through Jesus Christ by faith in His blood. Everybody needs to hear it. Acts 1:8 is the promise of power through the person of the Spirit for the purpose of proclaiming the gospel of Christ to people who need to know. The people who need to know are everyone. Every year, the Bill Rice Ranch, the ministry that we were a part of for a number of years, takes a trip up to New York. Have you all gone before? Yes, I'm pretty sure several have gone up to New York before from here. We go into the city, and we spend time down in the subway system, and we share the gospel basically with anybody who will listen. We set up what are called prayer stations. So we have these tables, and they have literature on them, and we pass out flyers that encourage people to come and pray with us if they have any needs. Well, they'll come. People will come and pray with you about needs that they have, money needs, or they need a home, or some people need a job, or some people are missing friends or family in the city. They're looking for them, and they'll ask prayer for that. And so we'll pray with them about whatever needs they have, and then we'll take a few moments and share with them what their greatest need is, which is the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, most often, when you're in New York City and you're handing out flyers and having people pray with you, most often those who are businessmen who are doing well in life, they don't have time for you. Now, to be perfectly fair, in New York City, you would live in sensory overload all the time if you stopped and talked to everybody who wanted to talk to you and wanted to give you something down in the subway system. There's just people everywhere, and it would be... Everybody walks around with earbuds, and I think that's just to maintain sanity. It's because there's so many people. But we're standing out there trying to reach. Most often, it's not the businessmen who come up and speak with us, but on occasion they do. When I was in the subway system one time, I was standing out by the table, and on the table we had a bunch of different tracts, and they were all in different languages. So we had English and Spanish and French, and Chinese and Korean and Russian, several different languages. And I was standing there, and of course I don't speak any but English, and I don't speak that well. And so when people come up, I just kind of like guess at what nationality they might be, and I'd say, I don't know, just start going down the line, and they'd say, English, oh, sorry, you know, whatever the case may be. Well, one guy came up one time, and he looked to me like he would speak English. But when he came up to the table, he reached down and took up a Chinese tract. Either Chinese or Korean, I'm not certain because I can't tell the difference. But he picked up this tract and started looking at it. And I said, hey, do you read that? Can you read that? And he goes, yes, I can. I said, oh. I said, well, my name's Tim. What's your name? And he said, I'm the Ramadan. I said, really? I thought the Ramadan was like a time of year. I didn't know it was a person. He goes, well, it is, and I'm him. Like, oh. Well, we continue to have conversation, and several times I tried to steer us into a conversation, but after just a couple minutes, it became real obvious that something had happened. I asked him, I said, can you read the track? He goes, yes, I can. So I got a little cynical, and I said, what does it say? And he said, Hashanua hohoho hakuho. I said, what does it mean? He goes, I don't know, I just read it. Okay. Well, there's more of everything in New York City. But after this amount of time, it was just obvious that he must have been on drugs and perhaps got a hold of something that was bad in it, and it fried his mind, his ability to think. He was probably about 22 or 23 years of age, and he left. And at first, like you, I kind of went, oh man, whoa. But a little bit later on, I thought to myself, how sad. Because here's a guy who at some point in his life had an opportunity to be able to hear and understand the gospel. And now, all things being equal, outside of an absolute miracle from God, he has no chance to understand it now. All things being equal, now this was probably 10 years ago, all things being equal, that man is dead, most likely. And if he had never received the Lord Jesus Christ, then he's separated forever from God in a place called hell. Well, it broke my heart. But after thinking about that for a while, it reminded me of another person that I met. It was in West Tennessee. Brittany and I, at the time, were traveling with other evangelists in revival meetings, and while the evangelists were preaching to the big people, we would take the little people into another room. So 4 years old through third grade, we would take them out during the preaching service, and we would have our own special kids club with them. And when I do the special kids club with them, I would take 5 days and I would explain the gospel. I would take 3 days to explain three different truths from John 3:16, what we looked at the other day. Three truths from John 3:16, and then after one truth each day, I would summarize it all. There was a young girl who came. I think she came first on Monday night. Her name was Kayla. I remember Kayla specifically from the beginning. She had long red hair, and her face was a long face. I mean, she wasn't happy. Now, she was obedient, and she did the things we asked her to do, but she just looked really sad. Come to find out, she was not normally allowed to come to church. Her mom wouldn't let her come, but her grandma attended the church, and her mom would let her come on occasion with her grandma. And so she came on Monday night, came back Tuesday night, came back Wednesday night. On Monday night, I teach them the truth from John 3:16 that I'm a sinner and I need help. On Tuesday night, we look at Jesus is God, he can help me. And then on Wednesday night, we look at if I believe, God will save me. We work on all three of these truths. I'm a sinner, I need help. Jesus is God, he can help me. If I believe, God will save me. And then on Thursday night, I summarize them all, and then I asked the group if there was anybody that would like to trust Christ. And I'd explain what it meant to trust Christ. And I would have them close their eyes, and then I would have them raise their hands if they wanted to trust Christ. And those that raised their hand, while everybody else's eyes were closed, I would have those ones look at me, and then I would instruct them as to what they should do as far as getting with someone so that we could answer questions and help them to trust Christ if they would like to. And kind of realize who was old enough and catching it well enough to really understand what was going on. So I asked on Thursday night who wanted to trust Christ, and Kayla's hand shot up, along with a couple of others. And so I had them look at me. When I got to Kayla, I said, would you like to trust Christ? And she shook her head, yes. I said, have you ever trusted Christ before? She shook her head, no. I said, well, as soon as we're finished, I want you to get with Miss Brittany, and Miss Brittany will help you. Well, Brittany had gone over to the other service to play for the invitation. And then as soon as it was done, I sent someone, and she came back over, and I got her connected with Kayla. And Kayla and Brittany went to the room, and Brittany said to Kayla, why did you want to talk to me tonight? And Kayla said to Miss Brittany, she said, Miss Brittany, I am a sinner and I need help. All right. Well, that night, Miss Brittany had to help Kayla trust the Lord Jesus Christ as a Savior. Now, I may never see Kayla again on this earth. All things being equal, I will not. But if Kayla trusted the Lord Jesus Christ that night, then someday in heaven, I'm going to see her again. And you might think to yourself, what does Kayla and the 23-year-old in New York City have in common? They both needed the Lord Jesus Christ. Everybody needs to hear the truth of the gospel.
Amen.
Your relatives, your neighbors, the people you see every day, the ones who are around you, the people who have tuned you out and turned you off, those who you think, I have no chance, no opportunity, they won't even give me a hearing. They need to hear the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Everyone needs to hear the gospel because everyone's under sin's curse. If Kayla had died 2 weeks before we came with the gospel of Jesus Christ, she and the 23-year-old would be in the same place. Everyone needs to hear the gospel. And then obviously this leads us into what is it they need to hear? Well, Acts 1:8 is the promise of power through the person of the Spirit for the purpose of proclaiming the gospel of Christ. What people need to hear is the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. I love this. This is so simple, so true, and we have made it more difficult than what it is. Look, the gospel is simply that Jesus Christ, God's Son, died on the cross for our sins. He was buried and he rose again the third day, proving that he's powerful enough to save all those who will put their trust in him. And if people will trust Christ, accept Jesus Christ, they can be saved. Okay, now look, that's the message people need to hear. I am 100% for our being kind and helping people with physical needs. It's good, it's right for us to help people who are in terrible situations to get water, to get food, to get blankets, and have their needs met. It is right for us as believers to be to have concern for the lives of the people that are around us. But friend, listen to me. If people are warm and full, but they die without Christ, they will spend forever in hell. They need to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. I say that only to encourage. If you do not have the ability at this point, if you're a believer, you've trusted Christ as Savior, but you don't have the ability at this point to be able to share with somebody the gospel, then friend, that's something that really you need to remedy. When you say, I'm not a good speaker, it's not about being a good speaker, it's just about being able to tell people about who Jesus is and what he did. You can do that. You can take my three truths from John 3:16. I'm a sinner, I need help. Jesus is God, he can help me. If I believe, God will save me. You can learn those three truths and share them from John 3:16. If you need help in learning how to give the gospel, talk to pastor. Let him give you some help. Well, you say, what if somebody asks me a question I don't know? That's easy. You say, you know what? I don't know that. But what I do know is that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and he died on the cross for your sins and for mine. He was buried and he rose again. And if you'll trust him, you can be saved. Amen. And then you can say, and my pastor knows everything about everything. So we can go talk to him about all your other questions. But what they need is the gospel. The gospel of Jesus Christ. Jesus says, you'll be witnesses unto me. That is, you're going to testify. You're going to tell people what I did, who I am, about what this is all about, and you can do that. Acts 1:8, the promise of power through the person of the Spirit for the purpose of proclaiming the gospel of Christ to people who need to know. Who needs to know? Everybody does, because everybody's under sin's curse and Christ died for everyone. What is it they need to know? They need to know the gospel. All right, and then lastly, the first part of verse number 8 says, Jesus said, but you'll receive power, ability, strength, after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. Okay, and this was great for the disciples. This was great for the disciples, but let me tell you, this is glorious for you and I.
Yeah.
The disciples received the power of the Holy Spirit about several weeks after this. So for a while. Now my math has gone from me. But many days after this, the Holy Spirit came in power on the disciples, and the disciples boldly proclaimed Jesus Christ, who he is and what he did, and God saved that day 3,000 people. The power of God is not diminished. And the Holy Spirit of God lives inside of every believer. Here's what helped me so much from this verse. When I realized that it isn't me that has to convince anyone. Right. It's not my responsibility to convince anyone about Jesus. I don't have to be smarter. I don't have to know more. I don't have to be a better debater. All I have to do is share the gospel and ask the Holy Spirit of God to take that and convince people with it. It's not on me to make people believe in Jesus Christ. I can't coerce anyone, and neither can you, and you don't have to worry about it. All you and I have to do is trust the Spirit of God to take the Word of God and convince people with it. Now, friend, all of us can do that. I will tell you this. I always want to be at the place in a relationship between myself and the Spirit of God that there's no hindrance in my life that would stop him from being able to use me. So that if I have sin, if I regard iniquity in my heart, God won't hear me, the Bible says. That is, there's a barrier that happens when I allow and enjoy sin in my life. So I don't want that to stand in the way. I don't want pride. I don't want fear. I don't want selfishness or bitterness. I don't want unforgiveness between me and somebody else. I don't want me having wronged someone to hinder my being able to share the gospel with them and the Holy Spirit being able to convince them. Boy, it'd be a shame, wouldn't it, to win all your arguments and lose the souls of the people that you won them against. It's not me that convinces them, but certainly the way that I live affects the message of the gospel. It affects the ability of the Holy Spirit to be able to convince because they have this barrier up. Okay, so I don't want anything in me, or I don't want anything between me and other people. But when all that's taken care of, what a glorious thing it is just to be able to say, hey, let me tell you what happened to me. Let me tell you about what God has done for me. I know that I'm on my way to heaven. I know my sins are forgiven because Jesus Christ, the Son of God, died for me. He was buried and he rose again. And he promised he would save me. And he'll save you too. Okay. Now purposefully tonight, I have tried not to use some kind of an emotional twist on the truth of the scripture to try and coerce believers into thinking, I got to get out and share the gospel with people. Because I don't think that was the intent of the Lord Jesus. I don't think that's the way that God wants us to think. But we do need to realize, and I would ask you to consider, do you know some people that need the gospel? I mean, are there some names that come to your mind of people who need to know the truth of the Lord Jesus Christ? Remember then what it is that they need to hear. And then ask the Holy Spirit to fill you and use you and trust Him to do it. Oh, if there's sin, known sin in your life, confess it, forsake it, get God's mercy and forgiveness. If there's something between you and someone else, go to them and confess it and get rid of it. Let whatever is going on go and get it out of the way so that you can openly share the gospel with that person. Let nothing stand in your life or between you and others that would hinder the message of the gospel. Acts 1:8 is the promise of power through the person of the Spirit for the purpose of proclaiming the gospel of Christ to people who need to know. Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? Oh, Peter, hey, Matthew, Bartholomew, hey, guys, come here. You're looking for the wrong power at the wrong time. Let me tell you the power you need. The power you need is the power of the Spirit to proclaim Jesus Christ, to be a witness to me, so that everyone can know that that's the only way, the only hope that they'll ever have of heaven. And you do all of this through the person of the Holy Spirit. Hey, let's, with confidence, with joy, with victory, share the truth that set us free. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I pray that tonight you would impress the truth of Acts 1:8, but also the whole conversation that took place at this time. Lord, help us, please, not to get caught up in those things which could steal our mind and hearts away from that which you gave as your last words before you ascended to the Father. I pray, dear Lord, that you'd please drive into our hearts, into our minds, the truth and the freedom with which we have the privilege of sharing with people who you are and what you've done. Will you please, God, open up doors of utterance, doors of opportunity for us to be able to share the gospel? And where fear would creep into our hearts, may we rather, dear God, have your Spirit grant us boldness. Help us to step out in faith, resting in the fact that your Spirit will enable us to share this gospel, and he'll do the convincing work. Help us to do it consistently, continuously. Certainly help us, dear Father, to be alert to the moving of your Spirit when you direct us to specific people so that we might give the gospel to people who need to know. Lord, we love you. And I ask in the name of Jesus Christ that you help us now in just the short continuation of this invitation time. With heads bowed and eyes closed, if I were to ask tonight how many of us should share the gospel more, I'm going to guess that most, if not all of us, could and perhaps would raise our hands. But tonight my question is this. I wonder who tonight would say by an upraised hand, Brother Tim, God has directed my heart specifically toward a specific person that I need to share the gospel with. And maybe involved in this is my learning to share the gospel. Or perhaps it is clearing up something between me and that other person, or between me and the Lord, so the Spirit can have freedom to use me in this way. But I wonder who tonight would say, Brother Tim, God has specifically instructed me, convinced me regarding my need to share the gospel with a specific person. And tonight, I'm making the decision by faith to trust the Holy Spirit to give me the enabling power to do what it is that the Lord Jesus, my Lord, my God, would have me to do. If that's true for you tonight, would you slip up your hand where you sit and let me pray for you? There's someone specific that I know of that I need to share the gospel with, and I know it. And God's dealt in my heart. Okay. I probably 7 or 8 hands. God bless you. Well, right now, as I pray, would you just ask the Lord to impress upon your heart this need, and then to open up an opportunity. And then, friend, not in the flesh, certainly not in your flesh, thinking you're the one that's going to do the convincing, but by the power of the Holy Spirit, would you trust God to enable you to share the gospel? And for all of us and each of us here tonight, those who know the Lord Jesus Christ as a Savior, would you ask the Lord to help you to be aware of opportunities that you have to share the gospel? People need to know, without Christ there is no hope. Then the last question is this. I wonder who tonight, or how many tonight rather, would say, Tim, to be perfectly honest, if I were to die tonight, I don't know for certain that I'm saved. I don't know for certain that I'm on my way to heaven. I don't know that I've received Jesus Christ as my personal Savior, but I would like to, or I have questions about it. And you'd say by an upraised hand, Tim, would you please pray for me? Are there some like that? Would you slip up your hand where you sit and let me pray for you? Tim, I don't know for certain that I'm on my way to heaven. I don't know for certain that I'm saved, that I've trusted the Lord Jesus Christ, but I'd like to, or I have questions about it. Would you slip up your hand where you sit? Okay. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, please hear the prayers of your children as they come before you now. Would you please answer according to their request, and certainly for your glory and for the sake of the kingdom. I ask this, Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. With heads bowed and eyes closed, if you would, and you're able to, would everyone mind standing with me? As you stand, just keep eyes closed. I'm going to have Brittany play through a hymn of invitation as she does. If God dealt in your heart about something specifically, right where you are, may I invite you to either have a seat or to turn and kneel, talk to the Lord about it, and then when you're finished, stand to your feet, and when everyone's finished, then Pastor will come and close as he sees fit, as the piano begins to play. We come to you tonight grateful that you have provided all that is necessary for us to have forever forgiveness of our sins. And you did it when we were sinners. You committed your love toward us that while we were yet sinners, your Son, Jesus Christ, died for us. Thank you so much for that, Father. Lord, I pray that you'd help us to allow your Spirit to enable and empower us in the way that you did with the disciples when at Pentecost they declared Jesus Christ and his work on the cross to be for the sins of the people to whom they preached, and the people responded in faith. Dear God, would you please allow us to be a part of that ministry? I pray that you'd help us to get past ourselves and rest in you. And may it become such a normal part of who we are in our life, so as that we are constantly having our ears open to the speaking of your Spirit, so that we can be aware of those who need the gospel. Use us, Lord, please. Please, in Jesus' name I ask.
We've had a good week. We've seen people saved. We've had challenging preaching that has shown us Bible truth, reminded us of things that we need to live into practice. And we've made promises to God about the truth that we've responded to. Reminded of Ecclesiastes 5 when Solomon said, "Keep thy foot when thou goest into the house of God, and be more ready to hear than to give the sacrifice of fools, for they consider not that they do evil. Be not rash with thy mouth, and let not thine heart be hasty to utter anything before God. For God is in heaven, and thou upon earth. Therefore let thy words be few." I think that sometimes we think it's more honorable to be honest about our lack of commitment than to commit and not keep our commitment. You ever heard somebody say, "Well, I'm just telling it like it is," or "I'm just being honest about it"? And you see signs on the corners of streets where folks are holding up a sign that says, "I'm not going to lie, I just need beer," as though there's some kind of honor in telling the truth about something that's not honorable. The fact of the matter is that those of us who are believers are bought with a price. We belong to God, and our bodies and our souls are God's, and we're His servants. Before we were saved, we were the servants of the devil, an evil master. But as believers, we're servants of God, and we're not our own. It is a privilege to serve the Lord Jesus. I'm reminded of the words that Jesus said when He said, "Take my yoke upon you and learn of me." He said, "For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." He said, "Come unto me, all you that are heavy laden and are burdened." And the truth of the matter is that most of us are just about overloaded, aren't we? Just have so many things, so many cares. And if you were to have to give an answer or give a plan for what you're going to do about all the problems that you have, it's more than you can handle, more than you can bear. But Jesus said, "Give me that, and I'll give you my burden." And Jesus' burden is the gospel. It's the gospel. And He said, "My yoke is easy, my burden's light." My friend, I'll just tell you something. If you commit to carrying the burden that you're supposed to and let Jesus carry the burden that you cannot, then God will enable you to do it. And I'm reminded of the importance, not of being careful not to commit anything to God, but I'm reminded of the importance of having the character to keep our commitments. "When thou vowest a vow unto God, defer not to pay it. For he hath no pleasure in fools. Pay that which thou hast vowed. Better it is that thou shouldest not vow than that thou shouldest vow and not pay. Suffer not thy mouth to cause thy flesh to sin. Neither say thou before the angel that is in error. And wherefore should God be angry at thy voice and destroy the work of thine hands?" I'm not trying to frighten anybody or scare anybody into anything. But if you told God that you're going to share the gospel with a family member or a friend, God expects you to keep your word the way that He keeps His. I love that phrase, "He is in heaven, thou on earth." In other words, you can't tell God, "Well, you know, God, you got to understand where I live." God knows where you live, but He understands truth. And when you make a promise to God, it's on the basis of His character, not yours. Friend, I think we ought to be Christians with character this year. We ought to let God take care of the things that we can't handle. We ought to just have enough faith to trust Him. Say, "God, I cannot, but You can. Here you go. And God, the things that You've shown me that You want me to do, with Your help, I'll do them." And my friend, you will find not only that God is able, but you'll find what real living is if you do the things that matter, the things you've committed to the Lord, and you have the commitment and the character to it. I'd recommend for you Ecclesiastes 5. Study that passage of Scripture. It's been a real help to me. Careful many times not to tell God, "God, I'll do it," unless I'm going to do it. We could use some committed Christians, couldn't we?
Yes.
Wouldn't Fort Lauderdale Baptist Church be a lot better if folks did what they said, meant what they said, and did what they said with God's help? And let's do it. Thank you to the Thompson family for ministering to us this week. Your family is a blessing to us, and we're grateful to God for you. You're an encouragement in your service to the Lord. We love to see you serving God not only here, but all over the United States and everywhere that the Lord leads you to. And we don't take for granted your ministry and for the investment that you've made this week. We know it was a lot, and we're thankful to you for that. And if you're thankful, it would help sometimes just to say, "I'm grateful that God used you in our church this week." And we have been helped, and we're looking forward to what God's going to do this year as we keep our commitments to Him. Thanks for being here this evening. I hope you go home and get plenty of rest tonight. No service here, but there's service tomorrow night in Miami Beach, but no service here tomorrow evening. And so make sure that you're well rested and that you have your spiritual priorities in place to be well and ready to serve the Lord and to be in church on Sunday, Lord willing. Let's pray and let's dismiss this evening. Our Father, You have been very good and very gracious to us. Lord, You really blessed us by giving us this special week where we could be ministered to. We literally could have our spiritual needs met. We could be fed the way that we needed to. And God, I thank You so much as well that not only have You been so good to us, but Lord, that the truths that we've seen, that we can go to Your Word and open it up, we can know what they are, and we can confidently live them out in our lives. Now, Lord, help us to understand in the day and age in which we live, when it seems as though no commitment is more honorable than a broken commitment, and where it seems as though broken commitments are the norm, help us to understand that by Your grace and with Your help, these things that You have laid on our hearts, that Your Holy Spirit has convicted us about, and that we have made vows to You about, Lord, that we can keep these things and these commitments and see you do miracles. We pray that that would be the testimony of each person who's made these promises to you this week. We pray in Jesus' name for your help. Amen. Thank you. You're dismissed.